good evening. If we can gather our thoughts and our bodies. Thank you. Thank you. Firstly, I'd like to apologize most profusely to the wonderful individual sitting at the other end of the room, and we do apologize for keeping you waiting. I don't recall that we've ever had to delay at the start of a meeting by 30 minutes before, so we do apologize most sincerely. And we will try to make this an interesting and succinct meeting for you. So thank you for being here. Joel is going to give us the opening prayer.
Thank you, Madam Chair. So in honor of the beginning of National Anti-Bullying Awareness Week, this prayer is devoted to that cause. So if you can all join me in the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Dear Lord, we come before you and raise up those who are being bullied, for those who are being hurt with cruel words, who are being tormented and suffering from physical abuse. For all who are suffering right now, we ask for your protection to surround them. For those who are being bullied at home, school, work, online, or within their community, please encircle them with your arms of love. Where there is such pain hidden away in darkness, we look to your everlasting light. Where lies are spoken, we look to your wonderful truth. For where words of harm have done great damage, please replace them with honeycomb words of kindness. Where bodies show scars and bruises of pain, we ask for your balm of healing to cover them. For where they feel that they have no worth, please encourage their hearts and come to know how special they are in your sight. Please open their eyes, Lord, to see your unending gifts of grace and mercy. May they feel you carry them where they are heavy laden under the weight of their burdens and anxiety. We thank you for your faithfulness and for hearing our prayer. In Jesus' name, amen. In the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, amen.
Thank you, Joel. That was a beautiful prayer. And also, congratulations to our student trustees who held a wonderful conference on anti-bullying at Holy Trinity today. That was excellent. Thank you. With regard to the motions adopted in camera, we have nothing to report at this point in time. So we will move on to the agenda. And we will add to the agenda under... Where did you have it, madam? Miscellaneous?
Yeah.
Under miscellaneous 11.2... we will add presentation by the Principals and Vice Principals Council. If you would kindly add that under miscellaneous 11.2. Thank you.
Can I have a mover for the...
Thing. Can I have a mover, please? I'm sorry, you had an addition? Sorry, yes. Go ahead.
I'd like to add an information item on HIAC.
Information on HIAC, and that will be 10.7.
Thank you.
Thank you. Sorry, I was so busy writing there. I didn't see you, Alison. Was there anything else, Ed? Okay. Seconded by Trustee Mariah. Any other questions? All in favor? Thank you.
Declaration
of conflict of interest? Seeing none. We do not have any delegations or presentations. So we'll go to 6.1, approval of the minutes of November the 4th regular board meeting. Can I have a mover, please?
Also move.
Ah, thank you. Trustee Rowe from Hong Kong, thank you. A seconder, please. Madam Vice Chair, any questions to the minutes? Trustee Danko.
Does that one say I was here?
Yes.
Thanks.
We always know that you're here, Anthony. Thank you. All in favor? Thank you. Business arising from the minutes on page 6. Any questions? Nope. All right. Good. Into action items 8.1. And for the visitors who are not normally here with us, the policies have been discussed at the policy committee meeting, and now the chair of the policy committee, Trustee Morrison, will present them. So it's not that we've seen these for the first time. We've spent many hours with these particular policies. So, Trustee Morrison.
Yes, dealing with 1-42, be it resolved that the Halton Catholic District School Board accept the recommendation of the Policy Committee and approve Policy 42 on medical conditions.
Thank you. A mover, Trustee Vienna, seconded by Trustee LeMay. Any questions? All in favor? Thank you. 8.2, policy B5, school accidents. Trustee Morrison. No problem. No problem. Your e-scribe's not working either? Does anyone close to you have a copy of that particular policy? You've got a written copy? All right, so e-scribe is down. Okay.
Be it resolved that the Halton Catholic District School Board accept the recommendation of the Policy Committee to approve policy V-5, school accidents, safety as amended.
Thank you.
A mover, please. Trustee Murray, seconded by Madam Vice Chair. Any questions? Trustee LeMay.
Thank you. Unfortunately, I wasn't here for the policy meeting because I have had surgery, but on the procedure, when you're talking about a serious illness or accident, including an injury to the head, and you're talking about having an ambulance being called immediately, and if it's not available, a taxi, if a taxi, a car. Has the medical profession been consulted on this? Like, you don't move anybody with a head injury in a car or a taxi. Because has the medical profession been consulted on this?
Trustee Morrison?
Superintendent Cipriano?
Superintendent Cipriano? Superintendent Hobholt? Just look like
someone will answer through you, Madam Chair. I will look further into this in regards to the rationale behind it. My guess, and again it's only a guess, but I will look further into it, would be if the whereabouts as to where the individual is has to be transported and the ambulance can't be there, then it would be to get them there as quickly as possible. But I will go further and find out what the rationale behind that was, because that was part of the policy from before.
I just can't imagine the medical profession agreeing with that.
Thank you. A very good comment. Any other questions to this? All right, so then I guess we've got a mover and a seconder. It's on the table. All in favor? Thank you. And if there is any change to that, then it will be amended. All right. 8.3... Policy I-35, Trustee Honoraria. Trustee Morrison.
Thank you, Madam Chair. Be it resolved that the Halton Catholic District School Board accept the recommendation of the Policy Committee and approve Policy 1-35, Trustee Honoraria, as amended.
Thank you. Can I have a mover? I've got a mover. A seconder, please. Trustee Viana, any questions? Trustee LeMay.
Thank you. On this one, it says under the components, and I know this is all in the Education Act that says, you know, it depends on the enrollment and what the base rate is. The base rate from 2006 was $5,900. That's still what it is today. But I wonder if somewhere, and I don't know whether it belongs in here, but specific to Halton Catholic, like if somebody wanted to say, okay, what do the trustees from Halton Catholic, because I bet you if you asked most of us around the table, I have no clue. So I know it depends on enrollment, and I know it depends on this, but what is the final amount, and where can we put this? So if the general public was reading this, they say, oh, this is what our trustees are being paid, and maybe it's not enough, maybe it's too much, but I mean, I've never questioned it, because it is an honoraria, it's not a salary. But I think for clarity, transparency, whatever, somewhere in here it should say that the base rate is this, the enrollment rate is this, I don't know if you get an increase for the cost of living or whatever you call it, and then the one for the chair and the vice chair, but the numbers should be in here. You know, and if you have
to
change it in 4 years, that's fine, but it should be in here.
I'll be with you in a minute, Trustee Michael. Mr. McMahon, Superintendent McMahon.
Thank you, Madam Chair. Through you to Trustee LeMay, we did provide the calculation and an information report a few board meetings ago, and Superintendent Cipriano can comment as well. We're not going to put the calculation here because the calculation changes every year as a result of enrollment. But if you look at the components, the 5,900 is in there. That's fixed for the next 4 years.
Right.
So in that, and I can, we can provide the information report. We gave it, Roxanna, do you know, it was a couple
okay,
of
so if you can't put it in the policy then, Paul, just if I may,
it's a table, and it shows exactly what each piece is, and it says, it works it out to the amount per trustee.
Okay, so if...
Which is 11, I think it's 11,900 per trustee,
yeah.
Roxanna,
yeah.
And it's right
but
on
then,
that schedule.
Okay, so if we don't put it in the policy, then perhaps just in the board website where we put in the trustee expenses or whatever, that, you know, you could put it in there on an annual, you know, like December the 1st of every year, put it in there so if people are looking for it, they know where to look.
Through you, Madam Chair, we could certainly do that. It's public information, and we could put it on that exact spot on the website, and Roxanna is furiously writing notes back there to that effect, so thank you.
Thank you. Trustee Michael, you have a question?
More of a comment. When canvassing this past time, people, I think, are under the mistaken assumption that we make the same as counselors. And did someone tell me one time that it was pretty well equal to the personal tax exemption on our income tax? Because it is.
Superintendent McMahon.
I would have to look up that number, but I think it is pretty close. That's around 10,000 something, if I recall. So I think that would be a fairly accurate comment.
Madam Vice Chair.
Thank you, Madam Chair. Just a point of clarification, because I don't recall us speaking to this at policy. On page 19, second paragraph in is attendance amount. And this is, the board may pay up to $50 for attendance at a meeting of a committee of the board that is required to be established by an act or regulations. We've never paid that, to my understanding, and we have no intention of doing that, just to be clear. Because this is the first time I've ever seen this. So.
Through you, Madam Chair, I was part of the process that did establish that. It was a stakeholder committee through CPIC. When this first came out, this regulation, which I believe was in 2006, and we decided that the attendance amount was not an amount that we, and it was, and that was brought forward to the board and approved, and it's never been changed, so we've continued with that practice.
Okay, that's fine. Thank you.
All in favor? Thank you. Policy 8.4, I'm sorry, number 8.4, policy 2-06, lunch supervision. Trustee Morrison.
Thank you, Madam Chair. We're all in this for the money, we know it. Be it resolved that the Halton Catholic District School Board accept the recommendation of the Policy Committee and approve policy 2-06, lunch supervision, as amended.
Thank you. Can I have a seconder, please? Trustee Michael. Any questions? I'm sorry, Trustee Rowe, I didn't see you there. Trustee Michael, any questions? All right, no questions. All in favor? Thank you. 8.5, policy 1-43, appropriate use of technology and digital citizenship, first reading. Trustee Morrison.
Thank you, Madam Chair. Be it resolved that the Halton Catholic District School Board accept the recommendation of the Policy Committee and approve policy 1-43, use of technology and digital citizenship at first reading.
Thank you.
Trustee Rowe, would you like to second that?
I will.
Thank you. Trustee Rowe, any questions? Trustee Mariah, and then Madam Vice Chair.
Thank you, Madam Chair. I just want to reiterate one comment I made at the policy meeting, which was on page 2 of this report, page 32 in your package, on the ownership of data. Board technology and all data stored on board technology are owned and may be accessed by the board. Users should have no exception of privacy in anything they create, store, send, or receive using board technology. This was just in reference to our students and their creative work that they do in the schools, and I believe that staff are looking at what other educational institutions are doing on this point
to see what, how we could incorporate potentially different language into the second reading or future versions of this.
We took those notes, Trustee Mariah, and this is first reading, so we'll bring it back to with amendments at our policy committee.
Madam Vice Chair, and then, I'm sorry, Madam Vice Chair, then Trustee Danko and Trustee Morrison, did you have a question? Oh, no, you're okay. All right. Arlene?
Just a comment. I would like to thank Trustee Morrison for being our chair the last several years and doing a fine job. I think you've done a great job being efficient and very professional, and we'll miss you at the helm there. Thank you so much.
Thank you. And Trustee Danko?
Thank you, Madam Chair. Out of this policy, is that are we expecting any new administrative procedures or memos to be issued under the guidance of this policy?
Madam Director?
Through you, Madam Chair. Probably admin procedures with regard to how, if technology is brought in by the students, and what kind of training would we expect our teachers to do with our students prior to the widespread use of BYOD and use of technology every year.
All right, no other questions? All in favor? Thank you. To Trustee Morrison, superb job. 8.6, the 2013-14 draft audited financial statements. That will be Superintendent McMahon. And for trustees, the motion is listed on page 65 of that section of the package. Page 65.
Thank you. Thank you, Madam Chair. This is the time every year where we bring forward our draft audited financial statements for approval by the board as required by the ministry. These statements were approved by the audit committee last night for submission to you as a board. The statements before you actually show a $1.3 million shortfall for the 2013-14 year. Against $315,000 that was expected, and that's discussed on page 64 in the second paragraph of the report. Roxana will have a slide or two on that upcoming. So Roxana is going to do a presentation to walk you through the financial statements that we did for the audit committee last night, and Janet Allen, our audit partner, give a wave, Janet, from KPMG, is here should trustees have any questions around the external audit. And so I'll turn it over to Roxanne, and I believe we have screens behind us and to the side where you could follow along if you along with your computer. Thank you, Madam Chair.
Thank you, Madam Chair. We prepared a few slides similar with last year just to explain the financial statement. They're very prescriptive in nature, and there's two standard reports, the Statement of Management Responsibility, which is outlining that the consolidated financial statements are the responsibility of management and that they have been prepared in accordance with the Financial Administration Act. The auditor's report is also a standard report. It outlines both the responsibility of management to prepare the financial statements and of the auditors to review them. And the important item to note is that they have a clean opinion or an unqualified opinion, and that means they've been prepared in all material respects in accordance with the Financial Administration Act and the Canadian Public Sector Accounting Standards, with a few exceptions with regards to property taxation, externally restricted contributions, and government transfers, explained further in Note 1 of the financial statement. The Statement of Financial Position essentially outlines the assets, liabilities, and accumulated surplus of the board. And it's on page 71 of your package. The next few slides will address this the Statement of Financial Position, or the balance sheet as it was called. And it would be good to look at them together, if you could, in terms of going back to various balances. And the Statement of Operations, or the income statement, is on the following page of 72 of your package. And it outlines the revenues and expenditures of the board and the annual surplus or deficit for the year. The statement of change in debt essentially outlines the changes in the tangible capital assets, acquisition, disposals, amortization. Statement of cash flows outlines changes in cash from operating, investing, and capital activities. And the notes of the financial statements will provide you with more information on the various items on the financial statements. As I mentioned, the statement of financial position from your package on page 71 shows what the board owes and owns, and we're going to be looking through the breakdown of the balances for the year and as they compare to prior year. Cash is very comparable with last year, $2.8 million, and it's mostly made out of school general funds. Account receivable is mostly made up of the last payment to be received from the four municipalities in terms of the property taxes and the EDC revenue, which is due for July and August payments. There's various other amounts receivable from the province for the GSNs or other provincial grants or the EPOs, comparable to the previous year again. Note 3 of your statements will further explain the long-term receivable. We've shown on the slide the made up, what is made up, making up this amount, and it's in short, any capital expenditures that we've incurred to date that are still to be debentured or have been debentured in the past, and we're receiving payments to pay down that debenture. The funding model has changed from the previous years where we had the new pupil places and we had debentures through the Ontario Financing Authority, the OFA. Currently, going forward, we have two funding sources for capital projects, and that is full-day kindergarten funding, or FDK funding, and capital priorities funding. And they are being received going forward twice a year, as opposed to waiting until the construction of a school is complete and then requesting for the debenture. Temporary borrowing is in note 4 of your, I believe, this one says 5. It's in note 4 of your financial statements, and I know in eScribe it had been updated. For some reason on the website it had not been updated in time. So note 4 of your financial statements outlines the makeup of the temporary borrowing.
On the EDCs, when we change the EDC rate, like, is that $55 million going to be less
recovered? The rate of the levies will allow us to recover this gap. So the $52.5 million is the gap between the revenue in EDC revenue received to date and the purchases of land that we've made to date. So that is the gap. That is the one, and it's a very good point, it is the one difference from the previous year. We did not have a credit facility for the EDC shortfall before, and we have entered this year into a banker's acceptance note for the amount of the shortfall gap, the funding gap, and any EDC revenue received every year we put into this credit facility, and this alleviates the strain that it was put on our general operating line of credit.
And I think Superintendent McMahon would like to add a comment.
Trustee LeMay is correct, though. The increase in the levy amounts that we did implement in 2013, and then we actually increased them in 2014, given the prices of land for our site purchases and the development costs, would help reduce that shortfall. So what we're doing is we're taking a 30-day BA, banker's acceptance, as Roxanne indicated, and rolling it over. We get the EDC levy payments from the four municipalities every month, and we draw that number down. It will go down by those payments, and it will go up by the site purchases that we buy. Right now, we're not in the throes of buying sites at this particular moment, but we will be.
The other change in the temporary borrowing that I would like to mention is the fact that we have paid down the credit facilities for the new construction of Jean Vanier and the addition of St. Ignatius of Loyola with the OFA debenture that we have received in March. So you'll see that the overall, compared to the prior year, the overall balance for temporary borrowing has decreased. The accounts payable and accrued liabilities are mostly made up of capital, they're as a result of the capital expenditures, and they're made up of outstanding invoices related to various construction projects, as well as capital holdbacks. It also includes benefits payable and a vacation accrual that we take into account at the end of the year. Deferred revenue is made up of capital grants that we have not, that we are receiving in year, but we have not yet spent. So they are deferred until we do spend that on different projects in the future. And the ones that we do receive every year currently are the school condition improvement grant, the school renewal, and the retrofit for child care. So those amounts will vary from year to year based on what we actually spend versus what the allocation is for the year. The employee benefits payable is an accounting number determined by actuaries. We have, again this year, done a full valuation with through our actuaries of the employee future benefits. There have been some changes in the discount rate, and that have resulted in a decrease in the liability of approximately 0.4 million from the previous year. The employee future benefits is made up of four main components. The retirement or the death gratuity liability has been frozen in time at the end of 2012, and it's been amortized over the 13.7 years that was determined. Again, that amortization period was determined by the actuaries. Post-retirement benefits have also been frozen in time at the end of 2013, and are amortized over 10 years. So these are the largest amounts, and they are going to continue to decrease from year to year. The compensated absences is not being amortized, and is an amount, an expense that will incur every year. And the other benefits are brought into compliance over 4 years in terms of the difference between the expenses and payments through the year. So they fluctuate a lot from year to year, I guess, is the summary of the slide. Net long-term liabilities in note 7 are linked to the slide that I had, where I had mentioned in slide 5, the long-term receivable. $196.5 million, which is what is called supported debentures, are also included in that receivable from the province. And those are debentures for which we have to receive payments from the ministry. And the long-term liabilities also made up of the what is called the unsupported debt of $13.1 million, which are debentures that the board has entered into for the use of school renewal on various capital assets in the past. And these unsupported capital spending is leading to a difference between our amortization expense for the capital assets and what we receive from the ministry as revenue for the amortization of the deferred capital contributions that comes into revenue to cover for that non-cash expense. And I will go over it in the next slide in more detail. As you know, we've issued the OFA debenture for $33.4 million, as I mentioned before, for the construction of Jean Vanier and Loyola. We do have, from this old funding model for capital projects, we have one more amount to debenture in March 2015 for about $1.9 million. That is what has remained on the venture to date, and then we will be moving on to only using the funding sources from the FDK funding and capital priorities that pay twice a year going forward. Deferred capital contributions are outlined in note 8 in more detail, and they essentially are an amount that offsets our tangible capital assets. It's a deferred revenue amount that comes is being amortized over the life of the asset, so comes into revenue to offset the non-cash amortization expense of our assets or the schools in the building. So the amortization expense for the tangible capital assets for the year is $12.8 million. The offsetting revenue for that, the amortization of deferred capital contributions, or DCC, is 11.1. The difference of 1.7 million between the two is being covered by the board. So that's the unsupported debt that we've mentioned. And we are paying it down going forward to minimize this gap in time, over time, and eliminate it. Tangible capital assets are broken down in note 9, and you will see it starts with the opening balance at the beginning of the year and goes through any additions and disposals, the amortization for the year, and the net book value. The change in tangible capital assets will impact temporary borrowing, as we have to pay the bills to our contractors before we actually get funding from the ministry, whether we do a debenture at the end of the project, whether we get the funding twice a year. The invoices are due before then. So we have those in temporary borrowing. We have the credit facilities but for the large projects that we borrow against, and then we pay off when the money comes in from the ministry. Long-term receivable is also impacted by this, as we spend the capital for on capital projects. That is a receivable from the ministry in terms of funding. So they are all connected, all those balances. And as I mentioned before, this hasn't been updated. It is on e-scribe. Note 10, actually, not 11, is the accumulated surplus for the board. And it's divided in three sections. A little bit difficult to understand. The top number is the non-designated surplus or deficit available for compliance, which is really the change, the operating change in the year. Then the board is restricting various funds, either through various reserves or committed capital on capital projects, or any rollovers on school budgets and student success plan, any programs that have enveloped amounts that we roll forward from year to year. You consider, you take this into account, and then you get to what the ministry is measuring that in terms of compliance. So the total accumulated surplus or deficit available for compliance is the middle of that table. And I do apologize, I know it's very small on the screen. However, in the middle column and the middle of that table, you'll notice the negative 1.268 million, so or the negative 1.3 million deficit, which is the in-year deficit or shortfall available for compliance. Add to that the amounts that are not available for compliance, such as the employee future benefits, liability, interest accrual on debentures, any balance on the school generated funds, or the revenues recognized to land to date, which is the biggest amount, the $77 million. And that's what gives us the annual accumulated surplus that is both available for compliance and not available for compliance. And a couple of numbers I would like to draw your attention to on this slide are the committed capital projects of $7 million, which are in the top part of the table. Those are committed from our reserves, the capital reserves of the board, and for capital expenditures already incurred that will come into revenue to cover for amortization on those projects. So this closes the gap of that unsupported capital spending that I mentioned before. School renewal program, that is our reserve, the capital reserve that we are building up. The amount is going to fluctuate from year to year based on what we spent on capital projects or what we put in terms of any revenues we may receive on, for example, the use of our facilities before and after care. So some revenue that we can allocate to this reserve to be used in the future on capital projects. And that really addresses the next couple of slides. I explain them all in one. So if we go to slide 16, the statement of operation, which is on page 72 of your package, outlines the revenues and expenditures of the board for the year, and we're going to compare them to the original budget and the prior year. The revenue compared to original budget is $2.2 million higher. It is as a result of an increase in enrollment than projected, but also as mostly as a result of other provincial grants received for the year. We do not budget, we do not forecast for these. We only include in the budget those that have been identified to date. So they will always be more at the end of the year, but they do have an offsetting expense. So the bottom line impact is zero, if you want, because you get revenue and you have an expenditure against that grant. As compared to the prior year, the revenue is $11.4 million higher, mostly as a result in increased enrollment, having additional schools. As we have more experienced teachers, we also incur higher salary costs. The other provincial grants are significantly higher than the previous year, $5.7 million, most of that being an increase in the FDK EPO, as it was the last FDK implementation stage. So the biggest amount of classes that have been funded half through the GSN and half through that other provincial grant. In 14, 15, and going forward, this is all being funded through the GSN. The expenditures compared to original budget are $4.8 million higher. If you take into account the employee future benefit decrease in the liability of $0.4 million, they're actually $5.2 million higher. And the main reason for this is the increase in salaries as a result of increase in paid sick leave and the increase in benefits, which is also outlined in the report. As compared to the prior year, expenditures are $14.4 million higher. Again, with increasing enrollment, the offset to that is the need for more teachers, an increase in salary expenditures. Pupil accommodation is comparable to the prior year, and this includes all of our operational expenditures on our schools, the maintenance, amortization, repayment of debentures. All of that is incorporated into that amount. Both transport, both the administration expenditures and transportation are slightly lower than the prior year. Any school general fund, any increase in expenditures will be as a result of increase in revenue, so they offset each other. And as I've outlined in the accumulated surplus table in the previous slide, the total surplus for the year, both available for compliance and unavailable for compliance, is $3.6 million. And how that is built up is based on the in-year operating deficit of $1.3 million that's available for compliance. And we add to that the EDC revenue of $4.6 million that has no corresponding expenditure at this time. So really, it's mostly EDC revenue that is not available for compliance, that is jacketed, that makes that $3.6 million surplus for the year. But the amount that we're measured on is the operating deficit of $1.3 million. I believe I've already went through how we have to restrict certain amounts, and some are jacketed for us, and we can only use them for a specific purpose. So the total accumulative surplus of the board that includes the revenue recognized for land, that includes the employee future benefits and any interest accrued on the ventures that are outside compliance, is at the end of the year $86.3 million, of which available for compliance is $14.4. Thank you.
Roxana. That was a lot of work. Thank you. Great job. Thank you very much. Great presentation. Any questions? Trustee Danko.
Madam Chair, the slide 22 says that some surplus is at the discretion of the board, or deficit is at the discretion of the board, and it gives one example. What are the other items that are at the discretion of the board?
Superintendent McMahon.
Thank you. At the discretion of the board, and I'm going to show you the slide 23, just the breakdown. If you look in the middle, the amounts restricted for future use by the board, so the working fund reserve, that is a reserve that the board restricts for the purpose of being used in the future, and it's essentially putting money aside as and when we can. The committed capital projects, again, those are have been amounts that have been used from the board's reserves, and we have decided to use them in order to complete or any work or additions or school renewal on various of our schools and properties. The school renewal program is what is left of that capital reserve that, again, we're building up based on any revenue that Superintendent Giacomo is his department is generating from the community use of schools and permits and before and after care. So those would be the amounts that the board has any say in jacketing. The student success and school budgets, they are with we have to roll those over, so those are amounts that are being rolled over from year to year. And then the top number, I guess, the current year surplus that is non-designated really is unjacketed, undistributed. That is really the available amount.
Madam Chair, if I may just add, however, that number is negative right now, 700,000. So in sum, to answer Trustee Danko's question, perhaps in a nutshell, these items are still committed. So the answer is we don't have a lot of wiggle room in the reserve amount that Roxana referred to available to do anything with. If you'll recall, in our 14-15 budget, we did set aside $500,000, which we would augment that $105,000 number there with. And we will be bringing the revised estimates to the board at the second board meeting in December, hopefully with that amount intact. We don't know yet. We're in the process of preparing those revised estimates. So that's in summation what those amounts pertain to.
Thank you.
Any other questions for our business experts? No? All right. So there is a motion. It is on page 65 of your package. Resolved that the board approve the attached 2013-2014 draft audited financial statements. We need a mover. You have a question?
Yes.
Hold on there, Alison, for a minute. Go ahead.
Observation. They are for different purposes. The committed interest earned refers to the sinking fund assets that we had in the past that earn interest, and they're being amortized over time. So it's not the same as the bottom number. Interest accrual is the interest accrued on the ventures that we have issued. So one is interest received, and one is interest expense.
Okay.
That was a great question.
Thank you, Trustee Viana. So you moved that to Trustee LeMay? Seconded by Trustee Viana. Any further questions? All in favor? Thank you. Thank you very much, Roxana. Thank you, Paul. All right. There are no staff reports, so we're into Section 10, Information Items, 10.1, Student Trustee Update. So which of our wonderful student trustees? Joe? Thank you.
Madam Chair?
Yes.
Oh, sorry, Trustee Rowe. Did I miss you? Mark, are you there?
Excuse for the rest of the meeting.
I'm sorry?
I'd like to be excused for the rest of the meeting.
Absolutely.
Please.
Thank you. Thank you so much for joining us. We look forward to seeing you in the future.
All right.
Thank you. Have a good day.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you. Bye-bye.
Thank you. And thank you to Bill, wherever Bill may be, for there you are. Thank you. That was great technology. Thank you. We are going back to Student Trustee Joel.
Thank you, Madam Chair. So today we had our fantastic bullying prevention contest launch at Holy Trinity this morning. We were able to hear from Ms. Pinelli and as well as Constable Dinsmore, who spoke to the students. We had three students as well as a teacher from every elementary and secondary school within Halton. So it was great to see that the students coming together. Myself and Jason, we gave a presentation outlining some of the issues that students face with regards to bullying, as well as showing them the past submissions. Our goal was to inspire them, showing them what the past submissions focused on so they know what to focus on for their submissions. From there, we actually had them split into their family of schools, led by a student senator. And the student center prepared questions pertaining to a certain topic of bullying, such as social media, diversity, school cliques, etc. So each different family of schools had a different conversation piece, which they discussed with the elementary and secondary school members. After they had discussed it for about 20 minutes, we went back into the theater and they presented their ideas to the rest of the group. So it was a good way of getting the students to participate in conversation without having to speak in front of a large amount of people. And I'm hoping that the students learned a lot. I just want to say an additional thank you to Mr. Viana, Ms. Urbenda, Ms. LeMay, and Ms. Pinelli, of course, for attending today's event. Your support always means the world to us and to the students. So I'd be happy to answer any questions regarding the launch or anything else.
Thank you. It was a wonderful day. Jason, Chloe, did you have anything you would like to add? No? Okay. Thank you. It was an excellent day. It's wonderful to see the tremendous growth in our students. So moving right along now, we are at 10.2, Educational Field Trip, Superintendent Pinelli.
Thank you, Madam Chair. Please find attached a list of the excursions that for your approval. I would like to apologize for the Corpus Christi trip that has already occurred. As you know, Madam Chair and the Director and Superintendent Knorr, we were in a situation where there had been some miscommunication internally at the school that didn't bring this to our attention until the Friday before the trip. So the decision was made at that point in time to allow them to proceed. If you have any further questions, I'd be happy to answer them. Or if you have specifically on that particular trip, the principal and vice principal are here to answer any of your questions.
Superintendent Pinelli, any questions from trustees? No? Okay, thank you very much. 10.3, Early Immersion Pilot Program, French Immersion. Superintendent Negro.
Through you, Madam Chair, I'm pleased to present the report on the Working Staff Advisory Committee for Milton Early French Immersion. I'd like to take you through the process that was undertaken to respond to the trustees' request to present options to keep families together at the May board meeting immediately following the Milton Boundary Review decision. This committee was struck and was represented by various parent designates in each of the schools affected in Milton. They were invited to a meeting in October. And I want to thank Superintendents Pinelli and Corbaccio for joining me at that meeting to provide a background to the original Milton Boundary Review decision. There was an extensive presentation, as you know, Madam Chair, and I want to thank you for your attendance as well. At that meeting, the committee was presented with this information and also three scenarios that represented both the status quo and scenarios that would keep families together in the EFI program in Milton. So you'll see in the report the three scenarios that were presented as the various options that we would ask parents in those school communities to comment on. At the end of that meeting, we had advised the committee representatives from schools that their role was to go back and to facilitate a discussion at the school's choice, whatever that discussion looked like, and to apprise the community that there would be a feedback process that they could engage in and offer the board their opinions on the three scenarios. The window of opportunity to provide this feedback was October 17th to October 31st. We did an extensive analysis of the data. I'm presenting you with the two most relevant tables that were accumulated based on the feedback. The first table talks about shows actually a summary of all the school communities and which scenarios they preferred. And you'll see that in that first table, scenario one garnered the most support from the respondents, and a relative split between scenario two and three. The second table really details the preferred scenario by parents with children in the early French immersion program. So if you look at the yes line, you'll see that there was really a split between scenario two and three. So in our meeting in November, just a few weeks ago, we presented these data and asked the committee to come up with a recommendation for the director. The recommendation would be would require a two-thirds majority vote. We went through a number of different discussions on the scenarios, and they were really good discussions, but by the end of the evening there was no particular scenario that could be recommended with a two-thirds majority. So the committee presented that, through myself, presented that information to Director Dawson, and from there Director Dawson will comment on the final decision.
Madam Director.
Thank you, through you, Madam Chair. First of all, I want to formally thank the advisory committee, the parents, Trustee Rabenda, senior staff, research department, principals, teachers, and consultants. This process that you worked through, I appreciate and value the time and effort that went in to review all these scenarios and the data that was gathered and the input that the representatives from the school communities gave and the work of the staff to prepare this advisory report to me. Based on the work that I see in the numbers, I would have to say that the feedback from the advisory committee also aligns with the recommendations that came forward from the Milton Boundary Review Committee, which validates our boundary review process. So based on that, I'm going to put forward that scenario one, where status quo, the EFI program is phased in at St. Benedict effective September
2015, and the current EFI students at St. Peter's would remain at that school until their grade 8 graduation. A note that I don't want to overlook was some of the things, the concerns that came forward from the group, and a few of them were that expressed that they were worried that the program not become isolated. So those students who remained at St. Peter's would not feel isolated because their students or their teachers could not meet or collaborate or learn from one another. And I can assure you that through Mr. Negro's department and curriculum that all the supports necessary to ensure that that learning experience is of high quality will continue. So that is my decision, Madam Chair.
Thank you. Any questions from the trustees? Trustee LeMay.
Thank you. just have a couple of things. The apprehension over splitting up a family. So if my home school is St. Anthony's and I have one child that's going to go into French immersion, so that means all my kids can go to St. Peter's, the way it stands right now, right? If you're not going to split families?
No, I'll ask Superintendent Pinelli to comment on the usual procedure that is followed for this type of request from a family.
This came up numerous times last year as well in our boundary review. It's very difficult in Milton. In fact, we have repeatedly, even when we've gone out to parents promoting the early French immersion, we've always talked about if you're making a decision, it's an individual decision that you are allowing your child to go into early French immersion, but that does not guarantee that the rest of the siblings will be able to go to the school.
Okay. It's just that statement said, not splitting up families.
Yeah.
Oh, okay. The consideration for secondary programming, we don't have French immersion at secondary, do
we? Yes, we do.
Where?
Bishop.
At Bishop Redding?
Yeah.
What, not in any other high school? But I thought it was extended French. Which is, how does
different.
That differ from French immersion?
Extended French constitutes 25% to 49% of a program, and immersion French constitutes 50% or more.
So they're getting the immersion at elementary.
So we have immersion programs in four early French immersion programs,
right,
starting in grade one, at four schools, in one in each municipality.
Right.
We also have extended French programs at nine schools across the four municipalities.
Right.
They begin in grade five.
Right.
And in extended French, there is less percentage of the day devoted to French courses.
Right. I don't know why that always has confused me,
okay,
but it has. Okay.
Any other questions, trustees? No? Okay, thank you. And now on 10.4, Extended Trip Advisory Committee, ETAC, Trip Proposal, Superintendent Overholt.
Thank you, Madam Chair. Before trustees is an information report on the extensive field trips that were brought to the committee in late October. Those requests came forward and the committee did look at all the trips and made sure that all the criteria that they followed met the guidelines of our field trip policy. I want to note that this year we have determined as a senior staff that the trips from Thomas Merton, which are trips that involve credit courses, that they come for because they do fall under the definition of an extended field trip. So those trips are listed under Thomas Merton, A, B, C, and D, and also the two last trips, Corpus Christi and Holy Trinity, those trips are for the next school year. So we have some for the 2014-15 school year and some for the March break of the 2015-16 school year. So I'd be happy to answer any questions.
Any questions? No? Okay. None? Thank you very much. Construction reports, 10.5, Superintendent Corbaccio.
Thank you, Madam Chair. Before you, you have our monthly construction reports. These will be the last reports for Queen of Heaven and for St. Benedict. The schools are essentially complete, but throughout the year we'll be doing numerous deficiency repairs as well as commissioning of the HVAC system. And the third report is the report for St. Francis of Assisi, the FDK and the addition project. The project, the kindergarten portion is completed, and we're waiting for the two classroom addition to be completed, which is on track to be done by the end of January, and we're hoping to have it ready in early January when the students return. I'd be pleased to answer any questions trustees may have.
Thank you. Any questions for Superintendent Carbaccio? You've satisfied them, Giacomo. They have no questions. Thank you. Point six, parent inquiry on early French immersion program, Oakville. The Director of Education.
Thank you, through you, Madam Chair. At our last board meeting of November the 4th, I spoke that I would bring an information report forward based on a number of emails that went back and forth between Trustee LeMay, Trustee Danko, and Trustee Vienna from a parent that asked for a French immersion program close to where they lived, Burl Oak and Lakeshore, with the example of St. Dominic's given to become a dual-track French immersion school, because the French immersion school in Oakville, St. Mary's, seemed to be too far for that family. Trustee LeMay, in her one of her replies, explained to the parent that it's still a pilot program at this point, and that we do have some difficulty obtaining early French immersion teachers, and I'm told by Superintendent Negro that approximately we need 13 due to attrition every year to when we add another grade for our whole district. And Trustee Danko also made a comment that we should discuss this at a board meeting. So I'm presenting this to you, and some of the remarks that I have made, that we are in the second year of operating a pilot program of early French immersion, and right now it's difficult to expand the program to other sites without a thorough evaluation of the success of the pilot, and additionally to expand any academic program in any of our schools, Oakville, Milton, Halton Hills, or even Burlington for elementary or secondary would require a complete review of existing programs. We'd have to look at enrollment trends and school accommodations in order to be able to align that with the board's long-term accommodation plan and with the process that is currently about to begin in Burlington. So I'm just recommending to trustees that if you would like a staff report, if you'd like to recommend a staff report with the necessary next steps to address program and school accommodation needs in Oakville, I would be open to receiving information from trustees.
Questions? Comments? Trustee Michael?
Question goes back. I'm sorry if this has been asked and answered previously, but when the pilot comes to an end, how long will it be till a decision is made to go forward with it?
Well, because it's early French immersion, the students would have to be out of grade 3, so those current students would be probably entering grade 4. Then that would be our completed pilot. We will have enough assessment data from that pilot to determine its success.
So they wouldn't have any lapse. Like if it was to continue, they wouldn't have any lapse in their French immersion education.
If it's deemed successful, we would continue that.
Did someone on this side, Trustee LeMay?
Well, just a comment, and I guess this has always concerned me with French immersion is the space within the schools. Like if you start with grade 1 French immersion, that's one classroom, and then that's two classrooms. So then you go to grade 2, and you need four classrooms, and then you need that. Well, is that, if the school doesn't have that kind of room by the end of grade 8, I mean, you're looking at 16 classrooms just for the French. Like, I don't see how all this is going to fit within the school without being detrimental to the fact that we are an English language board. Like, French is an option, and I love the, you know, the fact that we can offer it, but I guess it worries me that you're leaning one way or the other, that I don't know how to say it, but like, the accommodation would be very critical in the schools that we have.
Superintendent Negro is going to answer all your questions.
Through you, Madam Chair, to Trustee LeMay. That is definitely a consideration, and we would always be seeking to keep a balance of the dual track nature of the school. And so that would always be a consideration in any selection of a site where, you know, if we were ever to expand French immersion, and it would have been a consideration in the initial selection of the sites as well.
Thank you. Any other questions? All right, so I'm sorry, Trustee Danko.
Madam Chair, if the director wishes to have staff produce a report, I think that would be welcome. I would make
okay.
a motion. And it can be open-ended as to whenever the director would like to provide the report.
Seconded by Trustee Marai. Any questions to the motion? All in favor? Thank you. Moving on to 10.7, TIAC, it was Trustee LeMay.
Thank you. Last night we had the 25th anniversary of TIAC, and I was there, Paula was there, and it was a very moving event because it took you back to the beginning of TIAC and how well Halton has done with the Halton Industry Education Council to the point that there was a huge conference in Washington, D.C., and Kelly Hoey was asked to do a presentation of the success of TIAC in Halton to all of these people at this conference in Washington, D.C., because apparently the TIAC program that we have going with our two boards is very, very well known across the United States and Canada as to be one of the most successful industry education councils that exist today. And so it makes me feel very proud. Like, I can remember the first time going with the grade 8 students 25 years ago to this little room, and I mean, we were squished in there with all these kids, but I don't know how many students they take every year. And I know Attridge provides the busing for everybody. So it's just a wonderful experience for the grade 8s to start to look at what are my possibilities, what do I think I might like to do, and it's a good start for the pathways that they might choose to take. So anyway, it was a great evening, and thanks again for today, for Eddie and I, for the bullying. It was also a very good event this morning, so it's been very busy. Thank you.
Thank you, and TIAC is a vital partner in our children's education. So now we are on to miscellaneous items, 11.1, OCSTA resolutions for 2015 AGM. Madam Director.
Thank you, Madam Chair. At this current time, we do have up until, I think it's the beginning or the end of January, to submit resolutions for the OCSTA executive to put forward at the AGM. I received one resolution. It's in your package on page 123, and it was submitted by Trustee LeMay. So if there's any comments or questions, myself or Trustee LeMay would be happy to take them.
Any questions or comments? It's on page 123, as Madam Director had indicated, and we'll need a mover and a seconder. Trustee LeMay? Madam Vice Chair, you seconding that? Any questions to that resolution? All in favor? Thank you. Yes? That's next. We're keeping the best to last. Okay, Ed? Will you introduce them? Okay. We do have a presentation from our Principals and Vice Principals Council, and Madam Director will introduce them.
I'm very pleased this evening to ask the president of the Elementary Principal and Vice Principal's Council and principal of St. Gabriel's to make a presentation to a number of trustees this evening. Welcome, Liz.
I already made my first mistake. Okay. Good evening. First of all, I'd like to say thank you to Madam Chair and Director Dawson for giving us the opportunity to be here this evening. And we're here to say thank you to three very special people. And I would like to acknowledge my colleagues who are here with us. Many wanted to be here, and they send their regrets, but they are here in spirit. So we have Jennifer Yust, Principal of Canadian Martyrs. We have Carol Wahorski, Principal of St. Mary's. We have Susan Guzzo, Principal of St. Bernadette. We have Vince Monaco, Principal of St. Joan of Arc. And we have Josie Guerin, Principal of Holy Family. So we're all here, but there's a lot of us here in spirit. So, all right. So first of all, I would just like to let you know that we're here to pay tribute and say thank you to Trustee Allison, to Trustee Ed, and Trustee John. We're here to recognize all of your years of service and to show our appreciation. We have so much to thank the three of you for. And as administrators, we cannot thank you enough for the support that you have shown us over the years. You have made your presence be known by showing up at so many of our events and always in the name of Catholic education. When you walked into our schools for the many, many events, it was not only to bring greetings from the board, but always to show how you believe in all that we do. I remember being in Oakville, and Ed, every Christmas you would come with your liquor-filled chocolates as your little Christmas thank you, and we enjoyed your liquor-filled chocolates, so thank you very much. Always ready to shake our hands and ask about our families, and always a smile on your face, and always championing the cause of Catholic education. Thank you, Eddie. Alison, you are always ready to attend an event, whether in Oakville or in Burlington for the St. Gabriel's Pierogi Night, always there to show your support and love of Catholic education. We thank you. And of course, your incredible dedication that both of you have had and given to CPIC, working together in the name of Catholic education to continue to foster that very important relationship with home, school, and parish. Thank you. John, I have not had the privilege of getting to know you, although you sound like quite the policy guy. And I think you're going to be a hard act to follow, so well done. But you have a stellar reputation amongst our administrators. I've heard that your patience, pragmatism, and wisdom were always greatly appreciated in all that you did. We thank you for the last 4 years for being such an advocate for our schools, but especially for Catholic education. To Allison and Ed, in the words of C.S. Lewis, remember, you are never too old to set a new goal or dream a new dream. And may your goal and dream continue to include your dedication to Catholic education. That's not C.S. Lewis, that was me, that part. And on behalf of all the Halton Catholic District School Board principals and vice principals, thank you, Allison, Ed, and John, for all that you have done to promote our amazing gift of Catholic education. You will truly be missed. Thank you.
Thank you, Liz, Vince, Josie, Jennifer, Carol, and Susan. Thank you very much for being here and for your wonderful tribute on behalf of the Board of Trustees. We do appreciate it, so thank you very much. Pardon me? Yes, absolutely.
Thank you. For myself, I'd like to thank all of the principals who are here tonight. It's been quite the journey for 34 years. And when I was first elected to the board back in 1980, we didn't have 10,000 students, never mind 31,000 students. And it's been such a delight to see the board grow and develop and to have My own children go through the system, and now my grandchildren are going through the system. And the wonderful lifelong lessons that we all learn as we go down the road. And I think that, you know, having taken all the courses over the years and all the seminars and all the growth, I think that the one thing that that I think that the system, in particular the trustees, can learn from is our own faith development. I don't think we spend enough time on that, to get to know each other, but to learn about our faith and why we are here. The children, it's always been the children. I mean, like I said before, I don't even remember how much money we make, because it isn't about the money, thank God, because we'd all be poor. But it's about the kids, and to see the little ones grow and learn and mature. And to one little one at the Blessing at St. Mary's School, when I was on a tour of the junior kindergarten rooms, and I always go into a classroom and I would say, "Hi guys, how are you doing today?" And after the third classroom, this little voice says, "You're supposed to say good morning, boys and girls." And I thought, God, I've just been told off by a four-year-old. So I said, "Good morning, boys and girls." But those are the little things that keep the passion for the children, because it is always, always about the children. And I think that when you look at Halton Catholic and you look at other boards across the province, we have it down right. I mean, with the trustees and the staff and the students and everybody, we all know that we are one family. And I think that that is always the most important thing to keep in mind, that we are a family, and a family of people so interested in not just the intellect of the children, but their faith and how they mature and how they are going to be, I mean, I worry about them all the day, but how they are going to be down the road, find their place in the world and reach the potential that God gave them. And whether it's being an astrophysicist or whether it's being getting on a bus all by yourself and going from point A to point B, if that's what the gifts you have, then, you know, expand your gifts and learn from them all. So now I'll be quiet. Thank you very much. It's been wonderful. But I'm not going very far, so there you have it.
Ed?
Thank you to everyone. And I've been privileged to be here this long. I never thought I would be this long, but I guess people been elected me. And I never think about money we made on those days, because when I started in 1978 as a trustee, we were $200 a month. But it cost me more to be a trustee, because I take all that hours away from Ford, where was my main job, to attend the meetings. And at that time, we have meetings every week, sometimes twice and three times, even Saturdays and Sundays, when you have to go on a budget to find money with a deficit. We're back and forth. We have superintendents in this room. Was tough, but I did this for the classroom, for the boys and girls, for the students, for the future citizens of tomorrow. That was getting me going. Because when I was at the school, unfortunately or fortunately, on the front of my house was a school. The next was the church. Then the principal was coming down, or was the director, not director, was coming down and find no teacher, no students at the school. And he talked to my mom. He said, "Mrs. Vienna, where's the teacher, where's the students?" My mom said, "Oh, that is the end of school year. They're going on trips, so and so." I said, "I have a question." Then he asked a question about me, because I was in the school. And the teacher sent me back to do gardening and put me in the back of the class. So the that the director who lives in the city, with administration, then he talked to that teacher and he told me I was retarded. Next to that school was a teacher, was my neighbor, and my neighbor told that to my mom. My mom, she got this stuff. He said no. And that teacher defended me, and my mom, he said, no, Eddie is not retarded. He come here in my room. Look, I have a blackboard, and I have two boys, and he do math, he do writing, this and that. And the other teacher, and I feel that always impression, you know. And I came to Canada. I came to Canada, I was 19 years old in 1962. I went to a farm. After 2 years, I come down to Oakville because I want to attend school, night school. So I went to Purdue, night school. So I was there, bang, bang, bang. I was doing okay, and then I was asking questions. Finally, I never forget the principal face. It was an Italian background, Mr. Calderon, his name. And he told me, you and you, come to the office. So I went. I said, what are you guys, you ask me too many questions, Bian. He said, well, I come here to learn. I want to know this and that. I said, no, you cannot be here. He said, why not? He said, I pay taxes. But my language was not like today. It was half, you know. But we're getting along. He said, no. He said, these people come here used to have fun. And I'm doing this because I'm thinking to go up in the ladder. And you ask what you want to learn, but you're not going to learn, I think, here. So I keep going to school. After 2 weeks, Colby, he said, that's it. You are out. And he gave me a degree for 23 hours. And he said, and then he gave me the address of a gentleman to go to give me instruction at his home. He's a retired teacher. Then I was pissed off of them, I'm sorry, but I would, you know. I said, no, but I want to learn. I said, you know what? Someday I'm going to fight. I'm going to, and he said, you are a Catholic, you not belong here. He said, you know what? One day I'm going to fight. I'm going to make this school a Catholic school. He said, I believe you, but not going to be in my life. Then I keep fighting, then I make that school a Catholic. I buy it for $1 and we're off of the board. And it keep me going. And people been electing me. I won three acclamations. The first one was the acclamation, and I had two other acclamations. Then I finally started, time for retire. And I live in good hands, good director. I serve under five different directors. I think we're going to have a good board and go ahead. And thanks all for all you've done for me. I have a lot of friends. I make a lot of new friends. And goodbye, everybody.
John.
I was born in St. Michael's Hospital in 1955. To all of you, thank you for your nice comments over the last 2 weeks. Obviously, I'm going to miss it. One of the things that was important to me when I came on this board was to not have unusually long meetings, and I'm going to keep to that by just saying thank you very much, everybody.
Thank you. On behalf of the board, I can say you will all be truly missed, and we're very appreciative of your many contributions. We still have a few items that we have to discuss, and let me see, where are we? We're at number 12.1. It's correspondence, trustee honoraria. There is a letter in your package from the Catholic District School Board of Eastern Ontario. Does anyone have any questions or comments pertaining to that? No. And 12.2, OCSTA, the selection process for regional directors. I don't know if Madam Vice Chair would like to say anything to that.
Through you, Madam Chair. I don't have a lot to say. I think we will have to have some kind of discussion with the other boards to see how, you know, what their thoughts are on moving forward with this. I'm not really sure how we did it in the past, but certainly it's worth a discussion, because from the three boards, we will only have two representatives once Kathy Burtnick steps down, so it'll be worth some discussion somehow.
So we'll hear back from Madam Vice Chair on that. So 13 is an open question period. I don't know if we have any open questions. No open questions. So we now have to return to in camera. So we'd like to thank everyone who came to see our meeting and participate in our meeting this evening. And we do apologize again for our late start of the public session. So thank you very much. And our guest presenters that we had from earlier, you're kind enough to stay this long with us, so thank you.